keep it pyro.
It's pyroradio.com.
Yeah, yeah.
Our special guest, The Last Skeptic, is in the building.
Yeah.
Good, brother.
What are you saying, man? Thank you so much for having me.
Thank you for coming, man. We've been wanting to do this show on this topic for quite a long time. So on this show, we talk about social issues, etc., and kind of just get straight into it with our guests.
Great.
When you said that you've got this album out and it's about mental health and anxiety and depression, I thought this is the perfect time to set it off and let's really talk about this stuff.
Yeah.
So what made you want to make this album?
It was a tough album to make. So I'd like to think that all of my music has been inspired by the mad ups and downs that you have as a creative person anyway.
Yeah.
And every single one of my records, it might have come out as aggression. It might have come out as like, I don't know, like bitterness sometimes. You know what I mean? I've had an EP called I Don't Even Like You. I've had an EP called Revenge is the Best Success.
Yeah,
and then my first album was called Thanks for Trying, because it was like a really sarcastic, you know, feeling rejected by the industry, feeling rejected by whoever, and then really...
Those are some spiteful project names.
Yeah, big time, right? It's big time. Yeah. So that's
you like that being...
Fully co-signed.
You like revenge. You celebrate revenge.
I really like success. Revenge.
So, you know, like a lot of it, that's how it kind of came, you know, came through into my music via that. And like a lot of the subject matter, the sounds of the beats, they would always be super cinematic and super like full of depth and, you know, something
related
that,
to the title. Kind
exactly. And you would feel like, I always said that I wanted to make music that you could fight or cry to. You know what I mean? The full extremes of like, you know, so you actually feel something from it. Because what's the point of music, in, you know, if you don't? Like, I love like straight up like ignorant shit that I can play in a club. Yeah, of course. But that still evokes something from you. So,
You
know.
A lot of that comes from people having their like issues as well.
Exactly.
Those people like, we were talking about violence.
Yeah.
People like that are like violent in their lives quite a lot of the time of going through mental health problems themselves. Yeah. And there's,
you know, I see Gucci Mane.
It's relevant to so many things.
Yeah, big time.
I see Gucci Mane and Waka Flocka talking about how when they first started, they were just taking loads of drugs and they had loads of mental health problems. And
self-medicating, man.
Self-medicating.
And that's a big problem within our industry anyway, the self-medication that we kind of ignore, you know? Like, I personally ignore it with alcohol.
Yeah.
And I'm like, oh, it's not a problem. It's just booze, man. It's cool. It's nothing.
Yeah.
But it's still a big problem.
Yeah,
like Valiums, you know? I got big into, like, take prescriptions for a while because I was trying to avoid, you know, avoid, like, dealing with problems.
Yeah,
and a lot of people do that, especially, you know, with the Zanny thing. Everyone's talking about Zannies and the lean and all that stuff. Yeah, it feels great. I'm not going to lie. But what are you hiding? Why are you doing that? Because you don't want to exist in the present, you know?
Yeah.
And a lot of this album is called This Is Where It Gets Good. And I wanted to make an album like that kind of journeyed me navigating through, you know, how to survive. You know, I'm learning myself. I'm not you know, like expert at this.
So
you know?
How did that work in the studio?
Well, I record everything myself. So like
So you brought the artist to
you? So I brought the artist to me.
And then you spoke to them?
Yeah, I kind of, thing is with every person on that album, I have a personal relationship with them anyway. Mm. So they all understand like that I have a lot of ups and downs.
Okay.
So whether it be the musicians that they've been around playing in my band or playing on records with me for years, they just kind of understood straight away, a lot of it unspoken, where I wanted to make something that sounded like how I was feeling. So they would just go in and go, and if they were playing something too happy, I'd be like, no. you know what I'm doing. And
because we played Death as the first tune today.
Yeah.
I was like, yo, the song is dope.
Yeah.
But yo, that's some slit your wrist music.
Yeah.
that's
well, you know, that's what I want, people to feel something different. Not necessarily slitting your wrist, but I want people to feel like, you know, that. And that song Death, me, isn't actually about death. It's about like change. And like, it was written, I wrote it with the singer Cara Campbell. About
it's Cara,
the,
yeah?
Yeah, Cara Campbell. It's,
with the GH?
It's okay. Like the Welsh spelling.
I was calling it Cara.
And we wrote it about, both of us were like, you know, were writing, and I was at the end of a relationship, and she was in a place that she didn't want to be in, and I was like, okay, let's just write something about like the change, and like coming through something and trying to learn from it and get something. Yeah. from it, and like all the lyrics in that, like you know you can't, you're wasting time, you can't let this lie, like and it's about being stuck in a mentality, in a relationship or out of one, being stuck in a spiral of thinking and keeping on going down that same road of, this is how I feel, I can't get out of it, oh no, I can't stop thinking about not getting out of it, oh I'm just not gonna get out of bed, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
And I've done that, I still do that sometimes, and a lot of people I know do that too.
It's really common.
So
we were
common.
Saying that earlier, especially depression. I was saying we could just do a show on just depression.
Yeah.
Because in hip hop and grime and all that, it's mad common. Like,
so we've been asking a lot online today. I think the first thing I asked is like, what do we need to ask when we're going to be discussing mental health issues? What do you think is the biggest like problems we face like in society? We can talk about even in the music industry, but in society with facing mental health issues and also speaking about them?
I think it used to be that the big problem was people feeling comfortable enough to talk about it, especially guys. But in recent years, that's, you know, it's been a lot easier to talk about. Like, especially with rappers that I work with or whoever, really, everyone's just really open to it.
Yeah.
You know, and that's great because no one thinks you're a pussy if you're talking about feeling down.
Yeah, yeah.
But it was when we were growing up. Yeah, like, I certainly couldn't talk about that.
Yeah.
And like it's changed a lot now. The dynamics changed.
I was thinking those certain rappers we allow, like certain rappers used to be crazy honest in their music and like talk about feeling inside, like Ghost, Scarface, DMX. They will talk about some dark times. He's slipping, that's what I was saying. Like,
but now DMX is in a dark place and like people aren't as sympathetic anymore. Yeah.
True. I think it's just about having an open dialogue, but also respecting certain people. I was reading articles about it recently about how it's also important to respect people that aren't ready to talk about it. And like some people have been pressured, like, no, you have to be open, you have to talk. Some people aren't ready to talk about
That's true.
But it's about providing just an open and welcoming space. So if they do want to talk about it, it's all good. You know, everyone's ready. You know what I mean? It's an environment they can chat to, but it's about not pressuring people to, you know.
The prep is done.
I had a question what I wrote earlier about creative people and musicians specifically. And then I thought of asking it in two different ways. But do you think creative people are prone to depression?
Yeah, definitely. I think there's certain bits of our minds that are open a little bit more to that stuff. And I think it's a double-edged sword because I think we feed off of it too. I think we need it.
I did
a whole chat with Nihal like a couple of weeks ago about it, and he was like, do you need it? Like, and I was like, oh no, I'm live. What do I say? And like, is that a cop out?
That's really interesting.
Yeah, and I think there's part of it which I do. Like, I've especially when I was younger, I needed the ups and downs. Because if I felt like I was just there, then I'd have to experience it. Sorry, I'm doing, for people listening, I'm doing the middle. Like, if I felt like I was there, I wouldn't be living life. I wouldn't be present. Yeah. Like, I would just be present. And
that's,
I wouldn't be.
So real.
I think even in just.
Didn't even think about that. That's scary though.
I think even in just listening to music as well though, as a listener, like when you create music that makes people feel that emotion or make that connection with emotion they already feel.
Yeah.
Like, I revel in that slightly.
Yeah.
And that's another interesting point.
Yeah, especially, that's why I love that first song, because it's mad that I like the inside of our song. It's like,
he was saying at the beginning, you're at my funeral, play happy music.
Yeah.
Inappropriately happy though, not like just happy music.
But I was like, yo, but depressing music for life.
Of course. The thing is, at my funeral, I want everyone to be depressed. I want them to be crying. I want them to be looking down going, why are you not crying?
Yeah, but the music would be so happy, it would be depressing.
Yeah, true.
Like, I want it inappropriately happy, like, like Chance the Rapper or Shiny Happy People or something.
A friend of mine, like, who passed away, God bless her, she, as she was being cremated, she really wanted to have David Bowie playing. And so, like, as if she, what's that song that Ground Control to Major Tom, you know?
That's depressing. Yeah,
and so it was going in, but, and it was, because it's like Starman, you know, it's like going to space. It's kind of cool. Everyone was bawling.
I'll get the David Bowie song from Labyrinth.
Right, okay, that's a good choice.
That's the sound of the bird.
You could get like Who Let the Dogs Out or something, like really like mess with people.
Oh yeah, that would be dope.
That would be sick. I want that.
Going back to the album, was it a difficult, really difficult process? Like, you have to take yourself through these emotions.
Yeah. I think making a record as it is, as you know very well, is a difficult process because you're putting your entire life out there, and then you hope that people will like it. And it's never enough. So whatever happens at the end of it, you know, there's never enough people listening to it. There's never enough reviews or radio plays or whatever. And so I found it a fully cathartic like therapeutic process to actually go, you know what, I'm going to be feeling this way no matter what type of record I make. I may as well make a record that's so honest and so real that it doesn't matter.
You're just happy with the product.
Exactly. Yeah. And I was so happy. I had so many people going, throughout my career going, you need to stick to like one genre. You need to do this or do that. I'm like, no, I don't really want to. I want to make a weird electronic trip hop album that has some rap on it. Why can't I?
There's no limits anymore.
You
got the internet, so you will find the people that want to hear
exactly.
it.
Exactly. Yeah.
Yes. You touched on a point we talk about quite a lot about creating music being therapeutic. Mm. There.
Yeah.
So that's like moving on to solutions. Mm. Is that creating music?
Yeah.
One of your main forms of therapy or forms of solution.
Big time. Yeah. And I know when I'm really down when I can't make music. And I almost forget that's the easy way out for me to get out of it. If I just sit down and make it. If I make a beat, I feel great straight away.
Yeah, that's true.
But
yeah.
I go months without making any music because I just can't.
Oh, that's,
it's like I'm dwelling.
When I get down, that's all I can do. I realized at one point, a couple of years ago, I was going through some stuff and I literally couldn't do anything else.
Yeah.
And I made an album at that time. I've made an album, it still hasn't come out. But I made this album, I think I made it in 5 weeks, most of it.
Great.
And I couldn't do anything else. I had a job at the time. Yeah. I was supposed to work from home.
Yeah.
So managing my own hours, I couldn't do any of that. Yeah. I was just nah, music, that's it.
That's great though, that you could focus on that. That's really very positive.
I'm like
skeptic. I can't when I'm mad low, I can't do nothing.
You can't do it because it's almost too real, because you have to face up to what you're feeling if you make music.
Oh no, of course. But and what got strange for me with that also is that I was still finishing that project for the last 2 years. Mm. And I left it for ages, and I was like, okay, I've got to go back to this now, and I've got to get this mixed and mastered. Then, when I was in a bit of a better place having to go back to it, it was really difficult.
Yeah, I bet.
Because I was like, oh.
Because it's a diary.
And I was like, I don't even really feel like what I was talking about in that time. And it's like now, it's like it started cutting a little bit. I'm still wrapping it up now, and every time I do go into it, it is a bit difficult.
But that's why it's so important, because it's a journal. It's your diary entries of that time, how you were feeling, and that will last forever. I listened to this album and I know exactly how I felt when I made every song. And I listened to it, I love listening to it, and it's not an ego thing, but I listened to it, I think it was 2 weeks ago where I was getting real down about one thing or another and I couldn't listen to anything else. Because a lot of the time I can't listen to other people's music because I critique myself. Doesn't matter what genre it is, I can't listen to it. It drives me insane. So I thought, you know what, I'm going to listen to my own album right now because I haven't done it. It's been coming out, I'm doing all this stuff, but sick. I haven't listened to it. You know, when do you listen to your own records? Actually listen.
Yeah, true.
And so I just sat down and it made me feel so good. It took me out of myself because I started observing my own, feelings and emotions. How did I feel back then? You know, why was I feeling like that? How have I moved on from that?
Yeah.
You know, have I made progress? And I think that's really important to do.
Are there other outlets or therapy or other type of things that you use other than music or that you advise for others?
Yeah, there's a couple of things that I sounds kind of jokey, but 100%. Yeah. If you are not a music person, whatever, just find something that you love and absorbs you. So I cook, man. When I hate music, I just cook all the time. I just cook some new stuff. Today I was just you know what? I can't make music. I've never learned how to poach an egg. I'm going to Google how to poach an egg and try and perfect it.
I poach eggs every day.
Is it?
That's Norma's life.
What? No way.
It's eight poached eggs a day.
Oh, man. So you've perfected it. So see, I was a chef at one point, but I still could never poach an egg. And so that was it. That was today. I was learning. I was throwing out eggs. I was burning the kitchen. And also I did mindfulness before. Mindfulness and meditation is so good. Again, that takes you to get out of bed and sit upright and listen to something
it really does.
But it's really good.
So what's mindfulness?
It's basically meditation without the, some people don't like the connotation of spirituality or religious aspects, even though meditation isn't necessarily.
Is it only the meditation element, or is mindfulness cover other things?
It kind of covers an all-round feeling of being in the present moment.
Present, yeah.
So that's what it is. In the here and now. It's about following your breaths. It's about, you know, letting your thoughts pass like clouds and not being defined by your thoughts, that they're just things that your brain has.
Yeah.
And they're just like negative and positive, treat them all the same.
Yeah.
They're just things that you can look at and go, oh, that's a thought, that's passing, that's not me.
Yeah, yeah. Mm-hmm.
And if you do that, then, you know, you have a lot more power over your thoughts.
Yeah.
And I did two mindfulness retreats in Totnes in the middle.
Oh, cool.
That was like a big part of like this, getting strength behind, you know, and getting past that. It was really difficult to do. Mm. You meditate like three times a day for an hour
each. So you went like a ways or somewhere to stay there.
Totnes. It's in a barn.
Wow. I thought you said Tottenham.
Went to Tottenham. Rural Tottenham.
Man said Tottenham. I know it's from the ends. I was
that's
like,
no.
Man went to Tottenham to go meditate. Yeah. That's not what I would do.
Yeah. And
where's Tottenham?
Tottenham is in Scotland. Like Dorset, like in the country, like deep countryside.
That sounds really dope, actually.
It's great. It's so good. And
Nova's eyes are lighting up right now.
I've done a bit of mindfulness. I've done CBT therapy, and it's same. Like a thing where I just go, you know, so weekly therapy, and I found it difficult to get my mind into some of the things they're trying to tell me to do. And meditating is one of the main things. And it's like, so getting up in the morning.
I find it difficult to do in a daily.
I haven't managed to incorporate it into
my
life.
You've got to do this, Sharpen Barn Retreat. Yeah, this is what it was. It's so good because when you get there, they take your phone. Well, I made them take my phone.
Okay.
I was like,
I thought I'd have to do that.
Yeah. I say, can you put this in the office where I cannot get this?
Yeah.
Phone, laptop, everything. And you go there. And it's silent. It's silent between that 9 p.m. and 9 a.m. So complete silence. And Wednesday is complete silent day, right? Which is so good. And if you want to not talk to the nine other people, the participants that are there, you don't have to.
So what, on those days, you can't talk to them?
On Wednesday, you can't talk to anyone. Yeah.
Ah.
Yeah, it's great, man.
That sounds like a good day.
It's great.
And no one can't talk to you.
Nope.
Oh, that's banging.
Yeah, it's good, right?
Right.
And so you wake up, you get woken up every morning at 6 a.m., and with like the little bells and all that, and then you go downstairs in silence because it's 6 a.m. and you can't chat to anyone until 9, and then you go and meditate for an hour. Then you have jobs. Like, so the first time I was there, I had to look after chickens. I've never looked after a chicken in my life, man. And it was sick. So it was so nice, man. Like, honestly. So you're in the, like, I'm there, it's pitch black, it's winter, and with wellies on, just like a London boy, like looking after chickens in silence. It was sick, hilarious, but
I'm gonna make this rule at my house. Wednesday,
silent day.
Yo, shut up.
Silent day. It's really nice because you get you're not allowed music. So your brain just like has all of this space all of a sudden.
Mm.
First 2 days you go a bit crazy, I'm not gonna lie.
You go through withdrawal
because you're like, what do I think?
On the other side it'll be worth it.
So
I think
worth
just on
it,
a level of like, because they were telling me at CBT to get up and meditate. Even I was at AA for a little bit, and they were saying get up in the morning and meditate. And I just never did it. So it's like having that space to get up, meditate, maybe an hour, whatever you're taking of time before I go on Facebook and start talking to people.
Yeah. But that's very hard to have that discipline. Discipline, man. For all of us. And you just have to find your own moments in your day in order to do it. Even if it's like a 2 minute moment when you're on the bus and you close your eyes and you just breathe and you follow your breaths. And you know what I mean? You're just mindful of your every noise around you and everything that's around you. I think it's just really important to just be present, and it helped me out a lot, and CBT helped me out a lot too.
Yeah,
you know, having therapy,
like that type of isolation, I think it works. Like when you do it like that, we take yourself away from things.
Yeah.
But when you're amongst stuff and you isolate yourself, that leads to further mental health problems.
Yeah, yeah, exactly. It's true. But yeah, there's another one which you can do called Vipassana that I haven't yet done because I'm
Vipassana.
Vipassana. VIPASSNA.
Okay. Wow, we didn't expect all that.
Yeah. And that is seriously like next level meditation that I am. You know, one day when I'm strong enough, I'll do it. It's 10 days in complete silence.
Oh wow.
And
that, and you meditate like 8 times a day, I think it is, and it's just you can't, no looking in anyone's eyes, no like laughing, no nothing.
And apparently no communication at all.
That's it at all for 10 days. And people, you'd like, apparently there's a time like about 3 or 4 days in where you get euphoric, like everything is, you know, if it's just mad. Like people just go crazy.
Time
and
goes
crying
slower
and like,
in those
yeah,
situations as well.
It's mad. It seems like you're there for like a year or something. But some people, like I heard stories of this guy that like, he's like a cage fighter and every year he competes and does all this mad stuff in Europe. And then before he goes home to his family, he goes and does Vipassana for 10 days to just get out all of like, you know, to get out all the aggression and sit with himself and then goes back to his family so that he's not, you know, taking out on them.
I did that in Felton back in the day for about
10
days.
There you go.
What are your thoughts on pharmaceutical solutions?
I mean, for me, like, I enjoy them, but I don't think that
not recreationally.
Yeah, right. But no, I know. But no, this is what I mean. Like, but I don't recommend them. They certainly don't solve anything.
Mm.
Like, I've had, you know, I've relied on them at my lowest, and. You know,
in your own self-medication, medicating, or
no,
being prescribed something.
Started out as being prescribed, and then just self-medicating and getting anywhere I could, and that happens because you know.
So you don't think it's like a long-term solution at all?
No, I don't. It's different because I can only speak on like myself as someone, you know, with depression issues and like OCD issues, and I can only speak on that on my personal experience because people with schizophrenia, they might need medication in order to survive. ADHD like might need certain things to you know that I can't speak on.
It's a difficult one, man. And we've been talking about this online and people have been going back and forth on sides of the argument.
Yeah.
Certain people like mental health medication has saved my life.
Yeah, exactly.
Other
people
are like, it's almost killed me.
Yeah.
So it's like, yo.
It's very tough to like speak, you know, broadly about it. But I can speak personally where I think that, you know, I don't think it's a good thing for me particularly because I just will, you know, I enjoy feeling flat sometimes and it's an easy way out. So, you know, it's an easy way of not having to think about anything.
Yeah,
you know what I mean?
So have you gone, you touched on it earlier, but have you gone through that process then with substances that you've pulled away from and managed to like come out of the other side?
Definitely. Yeah, definitely. But I still, you know, like it's the Valiums of the world, which are the toughest to get off, and booze, of course, because booze is so like intertwined with my weekly life of like playing music, DJing, whatever.
Everywhere you go,
drink. I quit drinking 2 years ago now. I haven't been drinking, but I've never I never took any drugs in my life, so drink was my only thing.
Yeah,
well, weed before that, but I stopped that long before.
Great,
so yeah, two years ago, and like the experience I had, I think you probably touched on it a bit, is like now you've got to deal with facing life and whatever these actual underlying issues are of how you're feeling.
And thinking about death. That's my worry. Like when I'm not doing this stuff, that's where my brain goes straight away. That's frightening when you have to like, that's where you start thinking.
So does that relate to the title? Can you explain the title to us?
Yeah, it's
dope title.
I
like the titles to all his projects and I heard most of them today.
It takes a long time to think of them, you know, and like my other titles were more options for this album were more sarcastic. Way more sarcastic.
So what, can we hear any of them?
One of the second runner was "Someone's gonna have to clean this up."
That's a good one still.
That's a sick title. That's a potential. Yeah. And the jokes one was "I'm only here for the catering," which is true. Okay. Which is true.
Yeah.
Like with this title, it was really me telling myself, because there's a lot of self-fulfilling prophecy that sometimes I believe in, where you want to put out the energy that you want to get back from the world. And with me always being sarcastic with titles and I wanted to actually do something positive this time, where I can tell myself, okay, here's an album where it's got dark moments, you know, like moments about like living and just getting on with stuff and really aggressive moments, but you know, at the end of it all, it's fine because everything's gonna, you know, carry on. Mm. And this is the moment where you realize that things actually get better. So that's what I wanted. I wanted it to be about positivity.
With
and
all the artists on this project, did you pick them specifically because you thought that they'll capture the vibe of the project, or just they're your peoples?
They're all people that come to my house and record, and like, you know, that are around anyway. And they're definitely people that I know have like some of them struggled with emotions in their own way. Yeah, yeah. Like, you know, Trim, you know, he did an amazing aggressive tune on there that, like, where he captured everything that me and him had been talking about for months. You know what I mean? About, you know, about, like,
The
Tupac mentality of going, Trim's, it's me against the world, you know. I love that, you know, and that's what Trim just is great at doing that. Like,
great at just being like,
I don't need anybody. And you know, Koji's a poet, and he's so incredible at capturing emotion. And he did that perfectly. And the same with all the singers on there, you know. Very lucky to have those people around.
Kara Campbell, isn't it?
She's haunting.
What's next after this project? You got next things planned?
Yeah, I've got, because this came out on my label, so I've got a few of the next releases on the label. And I assume another album. I've already got like 4 songs done, with Koji. I've got like a bunch of Trim. I've got like 5 with Screwfizzer that need to come out.
And, are you ever not making an album?
No,
I'm never not making an album. You need to make an album. He's not making an album.
There you go. The inspiration out of peer pressure.
And obviously, we've got acting appearance of yourself and myself coming up in in Awate's new music video.
You two, man? The Fed?
We can't give it away.
Did you two fight each other?
No.
Okay, you're both fighting.
We both got beaten up.
Who would win in real life? Between you two and Awate, like, say if you two, no, I'm joking.
He had superpowers.
I don't know about your relationship. I don't know how you feel about the police, but I had struggled with whether I was going to do that or not. Awate hollered at me. He was like, "Yeah, can you play a police officer in my video?" And I was like, "I don't know about that. Like, I don't. Like, I know, like, you're calling all your token like white friends, not even talking token." But it was a fun day, and the video should come out soon.
Yeah, I'm excited to see that, man.
Now White's got dope ideas for videos.
I'm excited for his album. Really excited. That's gonna
be sick. Young talent coming up. To go back to the mental health thing. I was thinking, like, hip-hop is harsh, isn't it? Like, it's a harsh environment in general. Same with the grime and UK rap. Like, we're not friendly, innit? It's competitive. And sometimes, like, do you remember Charles Hamilton?
Yeah.
Do you remember when he just started going, like he was having mental health problems, for sure?
Yeah.
And we all just rejected him.
That's a good point.
And it happens a lot. Even Kanye right now.
Oh, yeah.
There's, like, no real love for mental health in hip-hop.
Big time.
Like, apart from when rappers talk about it on songs,
yeah,
but if they're acting out, yeah, you kind of reject them.
Yeah, that's true. Actually,
I was thinking about it. Like,
so what do we do about that?
I think we automatically don't give him the time of day because we think, well, they're rich.
Yeah,
they're rich, so, you know, they don't need our help. They don't need our sympathy.
Yeah,
and, you know, it's true. It's harder to relate to people that aren't in the same situation as us. You know what I mean? I can't relate with Kanye. Even though I love his music, he's sick. Like, but you know, when he's having these breakdowns, like, I even thought about it a few years ago about, like, Miley Cyrus. And she grew up in the industry. No wonder she went a bit crazy.
Yeah, on screen, like,
on screen, and does
child
all this
stars
stuff.
Always end up crazy.
Always. I felt sorry for her. I felt like these people around her family are all stars, and they all want her to be a star. That is incredible pressure to feel. And I started actually feeling sorry. Like, same with Justin Bieber.
Bieber right now, he's I was thinking,
what's going on with him at the moment?
Then I've joined some religious cult.
Is it?
Said what? I didn't even know that.
Yeah, something like that.
Yo, Bieber's my boy, man.
I saw it on
he's a believer.
He's a believer, man. How did I not know this? You didn't tell me.
I heard it on the Joe Budden podcast. Wow, man.
If Joe Budden says it, it's fact.
Joe Budden's another one, to be honest, actually.
He talks about it a lot as well.
He made an album. He made a few albums touching on this kind of stuff.
But I'm saying, them ones there that talk about it, like, in their music, and they're real honest about it, we love it. As long as they don't act it out, like, start behaving crazy in public, like, Cat Williams, DMX, certain people, I don't know. As soon as they start bugging, we just, like, we don't deal with them no more.
It's true. I think the key thing for, like, the most important thing for anyone listening is that to get help. Like, if you feel like you can't talk to the people around you, which is, I always highly recommend anyway, is just chatting to your mates, because it's, you know, your mates know you best. But if you can't, then just go into your GP and just, you know, get in therapy, because that's the beauty of NHS while we have it.
Who's Kanye's GP?
Who is Kanye's GP? He needs to find his local GP.
He probably does.
No, I agree though. I tell people I kind of am an advocate for therapy in a lot of ways. I don't know if the GP is the best place for it or not. I didn't get therapy from the GP. I went to them and they offered me CBT.
Right. Yeah, yeah. Because so the GP recommended me on to, you know, did the referral and and all that. But I think that's, you know, that's, it's a good way to start. But I think it's really super important to know. This is not what a lot of people forget to say, is if you don't get on with your therapist and you can't relate to your therapist, you don't have to have them.
Go
and get another one.
Yeah, I tell people that as well. Yeah, because try another one before another reject the team. Yeah,
exactly.
And I've been actually meaning, because I'm more into the, I've done like three types of therapy over the last couple of years. I did CBT, and then I did one therapy on my own, and then I did a couples therapy with my daughter's mom at one point. And the talk therapy thing was, I think, what I found the most beneficial. Yeah,
definitely.
Just getting stuff off my chest. So I've been meaning to go back. And I just started university again. And I thought to myself, I was about to like go and start looking for a private therapist. Mm. And then I thought, no, let me wait till I'm going to university.
Yeah.
They actually provide it.
They do.
So like if you're studying, these kind of things are available.
I did it at uni too. And it was, it's great. It's great that that's offered as a service. Like,
I'm so down. Uni offered it to me. I said no. Sit down.
What about Joe?
No, they didn't offer to my jail.
But didn't you do something?
I did therapy for other people in jail. Like when they were suicidal. The Samaritans trained man to do that, so if like someone was suicidal, I could go to their cell. They could call another prisoner to come to their cell to hear their problems. And then if they were suicidal, we didn't have to tell the officers. Because when they hire professionals, if the person says they're suicidal, they have to tell the officers, and then that person's being watched for like 72 hours.
Yeah, yeah. Mm.
But if someone's suicidal, watching them is not going to stop them killing themselves. Just wait till you stop.
So was it what, like, so it started, I'm sorry, even Big Ben now.
I'm fascinated. I want to know.
Yeah, like, was it a good enough system?
That was a good idea. Like the way they did it, so they got other prisoners to go and help and sit in other prisoners' cells and listen to them and their problems. Mm. And they gave us like a small amount of training.
Yeah.
That was the best way, because I feel like there's a couple of people just needed to talk to someone who wasn't against them.
You know what I'm saying? No, that's a good point, man.
Did it help you to talk, like talking, just because sometimes I think helping other people does help yourself.
That's a good point.
To an extent, but you know what? I can't lie. They should have given the people doing it therapy.
Yeah. That's a lot to take on.
I was stressed out a certain time. People telling me, oh, my son's dying. I'm not going to do life. I'm never. I'm like,
It's a lot. Lord, yeah, that's why therapists have therapists, isn't it? You know what I'm saying? In The Sopranos, you see, like, the therapist goes to a therapist.
And by the end, bare people called me because they knew I was, like, I'm not telling no one what was said to me. And then so, it's you end up seeing people that are your brethren and hearing their problems, and you actually feel proper sympathy for your brethren.
I
think it's by law, like, therapists have to have therapists.
Is it? Okay.
I think so, yeah. But if it's Samaritans, it's probably...
I feel like even in the ends, if we could talk to each other, like if there was someone from your community, like whatever class you are, whatever place you come from, people like you listening to your problems. They have more sympathy because they can kind of relate to where you're coming from.
Do you think, is there things in place like that?
I don't know.
I'm going to look into this.
If there was, the Tories probably got rid of it.
No, but maybe this is something
like youth centers.
Maybe this is something in communities that people need to put together.
I saw a thing like this in Zimbabwe where they just set up a bench and they trained these elder women in the community to just listen to people's problems and be the therapist. So people just go and sit on the bench, and they said they picked a public bench to take away the stigma of people talking about their mental health problems. So everyone just goes and sits with the elder woman who's been trained to listen to their problems.
Wow,
that's top.
I heard a story, it's kind of related, about Japan recently, where the people that had been lost in the typhoon, people that have lost people in the typhoon recently, you know, with the Fukushima and all that, and for the older men that just can't talk, like in a society that, you know, they feel like they can't talk to anyone about it, they just set up a phone box, like an old English phone box in these rural towns with just like not connected to anyone, and then people just go in and like call their family members and have a chat, like mad. Like, but it helps them.
What, like the lost family members?
It's they just pretend that they're talking to them.
Yeah.
Wow. Like it's quite
that's so sad.
Yeah, I know.
Bruh.
But it's at least it's a some form of therapy.
Yeah.
I guess we didn't touch on that a lot. To do with the causes, I suppose, as well. Traumatic experiences. Mm-hmm. There's a lot of if we look at traumatic experiences, things happening here, Grenfell, like, is there support for these people, like, actually from the government?
Of course, there's not enough. Like, you know, there's never enough. And especially with that, like, we're going to be dealing with people who have, like, a lifetime's worth of problems to work through. Mm. And, you know, of course, the Tories are not doing anything for them anyway. Housing-wise, how can you expect them to be doing anything?
Like, yeah.
Yeah, like, on the way here, I Googled austerity and suicide. And I was like, it's a madness. The cuts killed people. Like, 80 people a month, certain times.
Yeah.
Yeah.
At this height in 2013.
So is there maybe a political solution?
I think so. I mean, also, you know, if you're in a society which holds the capitalist ideals in such a high, you know, you know, regard, if you can't, like, keep up with the Joneses, and then on top of that you don't have a home and you don't have everything else, then what other way out is there? You know, there's like, there's people feel like there's no other way out, and especially when there's no services to help them. So
suicide's real common in England and Britain. I don't know why.
Yeah,
we love it.
Crazy, man.
Yeah.
So we've got a few solutions we've touched on today, which I'm happy about, though.
Yeah, man, you lot making me want to go therapy.
You should.
Great. I'm like the only guy in the room that ain't done it. I'm feeling proper left. I'm like,
it's crazy.
I often say I think everybody should do it.
Yeah,
you know what I'm saying, like, definitely at some point go and talk about things. Like, I said in the first half of this, I was explaining my own experience with a therapist, that I had moments of realization of things I'd gone through that were traumatic for me that I hadn't even realized were traumatic.
Yeah.
Just being in that room.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? And loads of people might be going through that kind of situation. Definitely. And going through stress, and they don't really know why. You know what I'm saying?
Big time.
When you think about, like, obviously American rappers, some of the stuff that they've been through that we know.
Yeah, yeah.
Like, 50 got shot 9 times. I wonder if he's been therapy and discussed that.
Yeah,
you know what I'm saying?
Think about that experience.
Yeah, like, even I used to produce for this rapper MF Grimm, like, in New York, and he's in a wheelchair. Sick. He got shot like 10 times. So I'm like, you think that going through that?
Yeah. Change of life, like,
you need to talk to people.
Yeah.
Whoever it is, like, whatever, like, just talk to someone about it.
How do we make that kind of community realize that they can talk to people, or they can do something, or maybe realize what they're going through if they don't see it?
I think, you know what, it's a slow change that I think we're making such progress in already.
Yeah,
from Grime Artists talking about it, definitely. And like us talking about it now, that we might not have been doing this 5 years ago.
Yeah, definitely.
And I think we're getting there. It's just to keep on, like, hammering it home to just everyone, just keep chatting about whatever, you know, be open and just not be embarrassed about it.
What if you're like a criminal and something happens to you while you're in commission of crime and it's left you post-traumatic stress disorder?
Yeah.
What are you going to tell about that?
That's true. Yeah, because you don't want anyone snitching on you. But, you know, therapy is entirely confidential. That's what I've been saying.
Apart from crime that's going to happen, or like,
unless there's harm to yourself or other people.
Yeah, so you can just bring up stuff that's not still active.
I brought up crime in therapy for 100%, and like, some of them stories I was talking about when those realizations were, but definitely like, nothing incriminating in that kind
of. But what I'm saying is kind of logical. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
Because if it is a whole thing, you can't really discuss all the details.
Yeah.
Like, if you're 50 Cent and you've been shot 9 times, you can't go therapist. Like,
50 Cent put all the details in his music.
Can you just listen to my album, please?
Yeah.
I suppose, tell people where they can get that album from, man.
It's a new album, The Last Skeptic, This Is Where It Gets Good, is available everywhere right now. So it's Spotify, iTunes, Bandcamp, everything. So go do that. And it's on vinyl too. So
I copped it on Bandcamp today.
Oh, thank you very much.
The money goes straight in, and then you can, you know what I mean? I was about to say you can get a pint later on. I always say that about myself, even though I'm not going to.
A pint of orange and lemonade.
Keep it pyro.